No formula, just mommy's healthy natural breast milk.
Yummy.
Her whole face just got swollen like this overnight.
Mm-hmm. No fever. Glands normal. Missing her vaccination dates.
We're not vaccinating.
Grib it.
The antibodies in Yummy Mummy only protect the kid for 6 months, which is why these companies think they can gouge you. They think that you'll spend whatever they ask to keep your kid alive. Want to change things? Prove them wrong. A few hundred parents like you decide they'd rather let their kid die than cough up $40 for a vaccination, and believe me, prices will drop really fast. Grib it.
Tell me what she has.
Health officials say children should be vaccinated or the country risks bringing back many rare diseases.
Anti-vaccine propaganda has long targeted immunization against childhood diseases like measles.
These outbreaks are due to the anti-vaccine movement.
There is no way, as long as I'm living, that my children are going to be injected with that.
Communicable diseases existed during humankind's hunter-gatherer days, but the shift to agrarian life 10,000 years ago created communities that made epidemics more possible. Malaria, tuberculosis, leprosy, influenza, smallpox, and others first appeared during this period. When an epidemic spreads beyond a country's borders, that's when the disease officially becomes a pandemic. The more civilized humans became, building cities and forging trade routes to connect to other cities and waging wars with them, the more likely pandemics became. The earliest recorded pandemic happened during the Peloponnesian War, between 431 and 404 BC. After the disease spread through Libya, Ethiopia, and Egypt, it crossed the Athenian walls as the Spartans laid siege, and over two-thirds of the population died. The disease, suspected to have been typhoid fever, weakened the Athenians significantly and was a main factor in their defeat by the Spartans. Fast forward to the Common Era, the development of vaccines began to change the way of preventing infectious diseases in humans. However, the story of vaccines did not begin with Edward Jenner's use of material from cowpox pustules to provide protection against smallpox. There is evidence that the Chinese employed smallpox inoculation as early as 10,000 CE. It was practiced in Africa and Turkey as well, before it spread to Europe and the Americas. In 1796, Edward Jenner's innovations, beginning with his successful use of cowpox material to create immunity to smallpox, quickly made the practice widespread. His method underwent medical and technological changes over the next 200 years, and eventually resulted in the eradication of smallpox. Louis Pasteur's 1885 rabies vaccine was the next to make an impact on human disease, and then, at the dawn of bacteriology, developments rapidly followed. Antitoxins and vaccines against diphtheria, tetanus, anthrax, cholera, plague, typhoid, tuberculosis, and more were developed through the 1930s. To understand how viruses work, we need to understand their structure. All viruses have the same basic structure, a core nucleic acid surrounded by protein. This structure lacks cytoplasm and is not a cell. Individual viruses only contain a single type of nucleic acid, either DNA or RNA. The DNA or RNA genome may be linear or circular, single-stranded or double-stranded. Viruses are classified in part by the nature of their genomes: RNA viruses, DNA viruses, or retroviruses. Nearly all viruses form a protein sheath, or capsid, around their nucleic core. The capsid is composed of one to a few different protein molecules repeated multiple times. The repeating units are called capsomeres. In several viruses, specialized enzymes are stored with the nucleic acid inside the capsid. One example is reverse transcriptase, which is required for retroviruses to complete their cycle and is not found in the host. This enzyme is needed early in the infection process and is carried within each virion. Many animal viruses have an envelope around the capsid that is rich in proteins, lipids, and glycoproteins. The lipids found in the envelope are derived from the host cell. However, the proteins in a virtual envelope are generally virally encoded. viral genomes vary greatly in both types of nucleic acid and number of strands. Some viruses, including those that cause flu, measles, and AIDS, possess RNA genomes. Most RNA viruses are single-stranded and are replicated and assembled in the cytosol of infected eukaryotic cells. RNA virus replication is error-prone, leading to high rates of mutation. This makes them difficult targets for the host immune system, vaccines, and antiviral drugs. In single-stranded RNA viruses, if the genome has the same base sequence as the mRNA used to produce viral proteins, then the genomic RNA can serve as the mRNA. Such viruses are called positive strand viruses. If the genome is complementary to the viral mRNA, then the virus is called a negative strand virus. A special class of RNA viruses called retroviruses have an RNA genome that is reverse transcribed into DNA by the enzyme reverse transcriptase. The DNA fragments produced by reverse transcription are often integrated into a host's chromosomal DNA. For example, the retrovirus, human immunodeficiency virus, or HIV, is the agent that causes acquired immunodeficiency syndrome, AIDS. Other viruses, such as the viruses causing smallpox and herpes, have DNA genomes. Most DNA viruses are double-stranded, and their DNA is replicated in the nucleus of eukaryotic host cells. Childhood vaccines protect children from a variety of serious or potential fatal diseases, including diphtheria, measles, mumps, rubella, polio, tetanus, whooping cough, and others. If these diseases seem uncommon or even unheard of, it's usually because these vaccines are doing their job. The diseases that childhood vaccines are meant to prevent are most likely to occur when a child is very young and the risk of complications is greatest. That makes early vaccination, sometimes beginning shortly after birth, essential. If you postpone vaccines until a child is older, it might be too late. Vaccines work by preparing the body's immune system for future exposure to disease-causing viruses or bacteria. Vaccines contain antigens, which are weakened bacteria or viruses that mimic the disease-causing agents. As a result of vaccination, the body's immune system thinks the antigens from the vaccine are foreign and shouldn't be in the body. But the antigens don't cause disease in the person receiving the vaccine. After receiving the vaccine, if the virus or bacteria that caused the real disease then enters the body in the future, the immune system is prepared and responds quickly and forcefully to attack the disease-causing agent to prevent the person from getting sick with the disease. Vaccines are frequently given by injection, but some are given by mouth and one is sprayed into the nose. Because immunization programs of the 20th and 21st century have been so successful, many of today's parents have never seen many vaccine-preventable diseases and do not understand the potential for them to reemerge. If too many individuals choose to not vaccinate themselves or their children, some diseases that are now rare or non-existent in this country may resurface. The viruses and bacteria that cause vaccine-preventable diseases and death still exist and can cause disease in people who are not protected by vaccines. For example, although measles has not been constantly present in the United States since 2000 and was declared eliminated in the U.S. that year, cases and outbreaks continue to occur. This is attributed to various factors, including the common occurrence of measles in many parts of the world, unvaccinated travelers with measles who are bringing the disease into the U.S. from other countries, and the spread of measles in communities in the U.S. where groups of people are unvaccinated. The U.S. closed out 2018 with a total of 17 outbreaks of measles, and cases had continued to occur in 2019. 2019 marked the greatest number of reported measles cases in the U.S. since 1992 and since measles was declared eliminated in 2000. Of those diagnosed with measles, approximately 10% required hospitalization. The majority of the cases are among people who are not vaccinated against measles. A vaccine is a medication. Like any medicine, vaccines have benefits and risks, and although highly effective, no vaccine is 100% effective in preventing disease or 100% effective in all individuals. Most side effects of vaccines are usually minor and short-lived. For example, a person may feel soreness at the injection site or experience a mild fever. Serious vaccine reactions are extremely rare, but they can happen. Marion Gruber, PhD and Director of the Office of Vaccines Research and Review and Center for Biologics Evaluation and Research, says, Parents should know that the risk of being harmed by a vaccine is significantly smaller than the risk of serious illness from infectious diseases. Vaccination is a very important step to get children off to a healthy start. The anti-vaccination movement made the list of the World Health Organization's top threats to global health in 2019. The organization said some people's reluctance or refusal to vaccinate threatens to reverse progress made against a host of preventable diseases. According to the WHO, vaccination is one of the most cost-effective ways of avoiding disease. It currently prevents 2 to 3 million deaths a year, and a further 1.5 million could be avoided if global coverage of vaccinations improved. The effects of what the WHO called vaccine hesitancy are already significant. For example, cases of measles have surged 30% worldwide in recent years, despite an effective vaccine that can prevent it. The WHO noted that some countries that were close to eliminating the disease have seen a resurgence. In the United States, approximately 100,000 young children have not been vaccinated against any of the 14 potentially serious diseases for which vaccines are recommended, according to a report released last year by the Centers for Disease Control and Prevention. While most American children are routinely vaccinated, the number who have received no vaccines by the age of 2 is slowly creeping up. Another major concern is the misinformation of vaccines causing autism. One vaccine ingredient that has been studied specifically is thimerosal, a mercury-based preservative used to prevent contamination of multi-dose vials of vaccines. Research shows that thimerosal does not cause autism spectrum disorder. In fact, a 2004 scientific review of external icons by the Institute of Medicine concluded that the evidence favors rejection of a causal relationship between thimerosal-containing vaccines and autism. Since 2003, there have been 9 CDC-funded or conducted studies that have found no link between thimerosal-containing vaccines and autism, as well as no link between measles, mumps, and rubella vaccine and autism in children. Currently, the only childhood vaccines that contain thimerosal are flu vaccines packaged in multi-dose vials. Currently, there is no vaccine to prevent infection with the COVID-19 virus, but researchers are racing to create one. Coronaviruses are a family of viruses that cause illnesses such as the common cold, severe acute respiratory syndrome, SARS, and the Middle East respiratory syndrome, MERS. COVID-19 is caused by a virus that is closely related to one that causes SARS. For this reason, scientists named the new virus SARS-CoV-2. Coronaviruses have a spike-like structure on their surface called an S-protein. The spike creates the corona-like or crown-like appearance that gives the viruses their name. The S-protein attaches to the surface of human cells. A vaccine that targets this protein would prevent it from binding to human cells and stop the virus from reproducing. The development of vaccines can take years. This is especially true when the vaccines involve new technologies that haven't been tested for safety or adapted to allow for mass production. Why does it take so long? First, a vaccine is tested in animals to see if it works and if it's safe. This testing must follow strict lab guidelines and generally takes 3 to 6 months. The manufacturing of vaccines also must follow quality and safety practices. Next comes testing in humans. Small phase 1 clinical trials evaluate the safety of the vaccine in humans. During phase 2, the formulation and doses of the vaccine are established to prove the vaccine's effectiveness. Finally, during phase 3, the safety and efficacy of a vaccine need to be demonstrated in a larger group of people. Because of the seriousness of the COVID-19 pandemic, vaccine regulators might fast-track some of these steps. But it's unlikely that a COVID-19 vaccine will become available sooner than 6 months after clinical trials start. Realistically, a vaccine will take 12 to 18 months or longer to develop and test in human clinical trials, and we don't know yet whether an effective vaccine is possible for this virus. You have a busy life and too much responsibility to risk getting sick. Vaccines can help you stay healthy so you don't miss work. If you can avoid getting sick, you'll have more time for your family, friends, and hobbies. Getting recommended vaccines can give you some peace of mind. You will have the best possible protection available against a number of serious diseases.